There have been so many updates from different AI companies, whether it's Anthropic releasing new updates to Claude or OpenAI releasing their new O1 model, all of these things that are really designed to improve the model's ability to reason and break down tasks to solve them more effectively. I'm Tula Masterman, and today we're going to be diving into how reasoning relates to tool calling and how tool calling is one of the primary ways that LLMs and SLMs, or language models, are being extended to be more and more agentic. So what is an agent? At its core, an agent is backed by a language model, and it typically has access to tools. Usually, the agent will have some sort of a system prompt or instructions about the role that it has and the way that it should use the tools that are provided to it. A key thing to note here is that the language model itself is not actually executing the code. A language model is only able to generate code, and the agentic part of the application is the thing that needs to actually execute the code in order to get the result from whatever functions the agent decides to use. So today, we're going to be focusing on tool calling, and we're going to cover a couple of key things. First, we're going to cover some of the challenges that are related to tool calling. Second, we're going to cover how to evaluate model tool calling capability. And then we're also going to dive into some different examples so that way you can see tool calling in action. Let's start with challenges. So some of the challenges with building agents are, a lot of times when we're looking at building an agent, there's a ton of different things it needs to manage at one time. It needs to manage the instructions for how to plan. It also needs to reconcile all the different tools that it has access to and know when to pick the right tool for the right scenario. Oftentimes it might also have demands around preventing prompt injections and things of that nature to make sure that the agent's only performing in the way that we want it to. All of this is leading to a trend where we're seeing that for a user, it might seem like they're interacting with one agent, but behind the scenes, it's actually a series of many different models or agents who are working together and owning different pieces of the puzzle, whether it's the planning piece or the tool calling piece. And all of these agents end up coming together to kind of be a part of one overall system that's ultimately executing whatever goal they're given. Now, when we're thinking about just the tool calling piece of this, there's still some key challenges to keep in mind. One is just around making sure that the model's actually able to call the right tools at the right time. Oftentimes, there's a lot of different tools that all might perform similar functions. For example, we might have some tools that are related to searching internal databases. We might have tools for searching internal SharePoint sites. We might have 50 different internal search tools and one agent, and it would need some sort of a way to reconcile all the different tools that it has and call the right tools at the right time. Or we might need to split these tools across multiple agents. Another challenge is just making sure we're selecting the right output formula. Most agents and in tool calling generation that we're seeing today is using the JSON format, but there's still kind of room for debate for what's really the right format for the model to understand and use when it's calling tools. As people are looking to fine-tune models for tool calling, we're seeing primarily people fine-tuning models that are doing JSON tool calling, but there's room to choose other languages or other formats, whether it's YAML or XML, that might end up being better for the agent's ability to call tools overall. The third challenge and thing to consider when we're thinking about tool calling and giving a model the ability to call tools effectively is making sure that we're building a robust enough data set. To make sure that that data set's robust, we want to make sure that it's representative of the types of challenges that that agent or model might come across. For example, if we know that we're going to use an agent in a multi-turn scenario, we want to make sure that the agent's actually able to call tools over multiple turns. If it needs to call tools in parallel or make nested tool calls, we want to make sure that all those different examples are representative in the data set that we're using for training a tool calling model specifically. Another trend and thing to keep in mind is when we're doing tool calling evaluations, if you release the data set that you use for tool calling publicly, there's a chance that other people might train on it. And so that data set might not be as good for evaluations in the future as it is today. So for that reason, we're seeing a lot of folks who end up releasing the majority of their data set online, but they still hold back some examples that only their internal research team has. So they'll be able to track over time on their own proprietary data set, whether or not their model's able to still perform as well as it should be on that data set or if it's getting better. So now we're going to transition into evaluation. And one key thing to note is when we're looking at tool calling, a lot of times we'll see research teams release not just the data set for tool calling, but they'll also end up releasing a fine-tuned model that's been trained specifically to perform tool calling. So some of the popular data sets and evaluation sets are the Berkeley Function Calling Leaderboard. I think this one is probably the most common tool calling data set that you'll run into. There's also a data dataset from NexusFlow, the Nexus tool calling dataset that's really popular. And there's a new one that is a little bit less common, but I think is really powerful, and that's from ToolAce. So the Berkeley Function Calling Leaderboard provides a ton of different examples of tool calling, and they actually have in their GitHub repository different examples for how you can evaluate your own model on their benchmarks. And they're consistently updating the Berkeley Function Calling Leaderboard with various examples. And I believe it was the V2 release, they actually had a bunch of user contributed examples for function calling that were added to the data set. And they recently released V3 of the leaderboard at the end of September. With the V3 version, they added multi-step and multi-turn examples to the data set, which is super awesome for anyone that's building agentic applications, because a lot of time it's going to require reasoning over multiple steps. So having some different tool calling examples that cover these use cases will be really, really helpful for AI developers. The Nexus function calling benchmark is similar. It has examples for single, parallel, and nested tool calls. And the Nexus team also has their own internal benchmarks that they'll use to evaluate their models, just further showing that trend where oftentimes developers and research labs are releasing many of the sample questions that they've been using, but not necessarily all of the examples. And then the third data set that I mentioned was from ToolAce. And in their paper, what was really interesting is the team behind ToolAce actually used agents to create a synthetic data set of over 26,000 different API calls. That's right, 26,000 different API calls. And I think this is just a great example of using AI to help you build AI applications. The paper's definitely worth a read, and they have their data set available on Hugging Face. And then they also have their model, which is a fine-tuned version of Llama 3.1. It's the ToolAce 8 billion parameter model. So definitely encourage you to check that out and try it for your different tool calling use cases. So now that we understand some of the challenges with tool calling, some of the different tools that we can use to evaluate tool calling, let's dive into some examples. The first place and the easiest place to get started is just going to ChatGPT directly. If you go into ChatGPT and you ask it, what's the latest AI news this week? You'll notice that the model is actually making a call to some sort of a search tool, and it's pulling back the latest information in AI news from the internet. It's important to note that if you want to see this in action, at least for now, you have to use one of the GPT-4 model series, because O1 is only focused on reasoning and it doesn't, at least yet, have the ability to call tools and interact with the internet directly. So using ChatGPT, you can kind of get a sense for how a model is able to call a tool and then integrate the response from that tool in its reply to you. So while the web searching functionality is awesome, for most developers, we really need to take it a step beyond just the web search. And we want to be able to define our own tools and then pass that to the agents that we're working with so they can actually interact with the tools that we define, since we know those are going to be more meaningful to the types of tasks we're performing in our professional lives and even in our personal lives. The next place to look to get a better sense of how models call tools is actually in the Databricks Playground. I definitely recommend using the Databricks Playground because it's a very user-friendly experience, and you can select a couple of different models that have tool calling capabilities. I would recommend looking at one of the Llama 3.2 models. If you pick the 405 billion parameter Llama 3.2 model, you'll see that it actually has the ability to perform function calling. And so if you click on one of the dropdowns, you can actually write your own functions, and then you can observe how the model would decide to call those tools, or you can use some of the predefined functions that they have. So for the sake of example, let's look at just the predefined functions, and we'll see that there's a function for getting the distance between locations and also getting the weather. So if I give the prompt that I'm going on a trip from LA to New York this weekend, how far is that and what's the weather like? I can see how the model is actually going to decide to use the tools that it has access to. And it's important to remember that in this type of UI, the model's not actually executing the tools, it's just returning what the tool call response would be. And then I, as the user, am inputting the value, so we can kind of get a sense for how what a sample response would look like. When you transition to building agents, then you would take the code generated by the LLM, run it somewhere, and then return the response. So in this example, the first thing it wants to do is get the distance between locations. So I can see that it selects Los Angeles as the first location and then New York as the second location, and then it prompts me to enter in the distance. I can go ahead and enter in that that's about 2,500 miles, and it's going to use the 2,500 miles I inputted as the sample distance when it eventually generates the response. You can also see that it created another tool call for get the current weather. So it takes in the location as a parameter, and then the unit, so Fahrenheit being the temperature unit that we use here in the US. And I'm gonna go ahead and type in 68 since that was the temperature in New York when I looked it up. And you can see the final response that I get from the model tells me that the distance between Los Angeles and New York is about 2,500 miles and the current temperature in New York is 68. So I might wanna pack accordingly. So this is a good way to just kind of get a sense for how well the functions you define are performing. I can see here the model really understood how it should use the get distance between locations and how it should use the get current weather function. Both of these are pretty simple functions. So if you're working with a bunch of different functions, it might be a good place just to play around with the different descriptions of the tools, the different parameters that you're passing to the tools in this playground environment, so you can better define your function definitions before incorporating them into your agent. And then the third level and where it gets the most exciting beyond just using something like ChatGPT and beyond using the playground is actually building your own agent. And there's a ton of different frameworks that you can use for this, whether it's in semantic kernel, whether it's in LangChain or LangGraph or Llama Index. We'll link some different documentation below so you can get a sense for how you can build agents with custom tools. The future of agentic systems will absolutely be driven by models who have really strong tool calling abilities and reasoning abilities. These things together allow agents to effectively interact with their environment and take action on your behalf in the best possible way. As the field evolves, I think that we'll continue to see a proliferation of tool calling specific models as well as reasoning specific models, and that these two models will be paired together to build really, really powerful agentic systems. One of the things to note is if you are building an agentic system that's using a reasoning model and a tool calling model, you can probably get pretty far with a larger language model who's able to handle both of those things. But if you're looking at using smaller language models, something in the 8 billion parameter range or less, that's probably going to do well on generally a conversational task or a tool calling task, not necessarily both at the same time. There's some different guidance that's been released from Meta as well as other companies that highlights that, but they've typically found that any model in the 8 billion parameter range or less does really well on, you know, tool calling only at one time or conversational tasks only at that time. Thanks so much for watching. We hope this was helpful. If you want to learn more about tool calling, feel free to check out the article linked below. We'll also have some links to how you can get started building agents and other different frameworks. Give this video a like and subscribe to our channel. Stay tuned for more. We look forward to diving into agents. And as always, feel free to comment how you're building with AI and other types of things that you'd like to see from us next.